Guess who got brands talking? Brandlive.co.za.
Good afternoon and welcome to Love and Relationship. My name is Ndun Indun. I will be sharing with you some wisdom keys about love and relationship. Stay tuned. Good afternoon to my listeners and also to my viewers on Facebook. Today we are back in the studio to unpack this mystery of abuse. Today we want to look at the preventive measure of abuse. We've been talking about this for the past 2 Mondays consecutively. And most of those talks were on the curative measure, how to overcome abuse and all that. But we believe that if it is not prevented, it can become a problem, a bigger problem for the society. So now we're going to narrow it to marriage. How do we avoid abuse in marriage? And I'm back in the studio with my wonderful guest, Reverend Shade Fasedemi. It's a pleasure and honor to have you. Welcome.
Thank you so much to all the viewers and the listeners. Thank you. It's great to be back.
You're welcome. And also with Pastor Salako. Thank you, sir, for coming through.
Always a pleasure to be here.
Thank you very much. Thank you. Today we want to just hit the points, get running through, because we don't want time to cut us through. You know, I had a little list of some things here that could cause abuse in marriage. I'm just going to run through the list. I believe you people have something to add to this and that. You know, I found out that things like lack of patience can be a problem. It can begin an abuse where people are not patient for the other person to grow up, to understand things their own way. I found out that sweeping things under the carpet can also cause abuse, where there is a problem and you don't say it and you just sweep it under the carpet. When you now say it, it becomes like a big thing. It's like an explosion. I found out that lack of effective communication can cause abuse, where people talk to each other in a way that the other person cannot receive. So the person feels that he or she is being verbally abused. So, you know, that can also be a problem. I even find out also that lack of an enjoyable sex life in marriage can also, it can stir up abuse too, because people are not satisfied. I also find out that not paying attention to each other's need can also stir up abuse, because sometimes abuse is like people fighting for themselves, saying, want to take things forcefully. I want this and you're not giving it to me. I find out that lack of self-control when angry, anger can be a major cause. In fact, for me, I believe anger can ignite abuse. It's one of the major things that ignite abuse. So when people don't have self-control when they're angry is a problem. Another thing I find out is comparing your partner with someone else you know can also be a problem, because when you are comparing your partner with this other person and the person feels inferior, the person feels, you know, he or she lacks that self-esteem, it can become a problem. Competing with your spouse instead of complimenting one another can stir up abuse. And also financial stress. These are just a list of things I'm just running through. We are going to discuss a whole lot of them as God leads us in this. But we want to make sure that, please, our viewers and listeners, you can prevent abuse in whatever form. Whether as a victim or as a perpetrator, you can prevent it. Because prevention is always better than cure. So I would like to start with you, Reverend Shade. What will you say to things that causes abuse? And, how do we prevent abuse? Because that's our major target today.
Okay. I believe a whole lot of issues around behavior, your background, your previous experiences, the state of your emotion, your spiritual temperature, what can you handle, what can you handle? These are all the things that create and that will influence and open up the door for potential abuse in any marriage. I think you've given us a very nice list right there, because that list is just all the behavioral characteristics that one can expect that are complementary of an abusive situation. But I think if I'm supposed to give the most important subjects to focus to the beginning of abuse, it's usually what's in your history.
Okay.
Whatever
your background
is in your history.
Okay.
Whatever is in your background, whatever has created your vision of a good or a bad marriage has all the ability to create the platform for abuse.
Wow, okay.
So when we getting married, it's important to know the individual you will marry and understand their history.
Their history. Wow, well done. That's well said. I also want to speak to Pastor Salako. What is your own input on things that cause abuse in marriage?
I think one of the things that causes abuse in marriage is not having a proper expectation of one another.
Okay.
A lot of people believe that when I get married, this man, this woman is going to solve all my problems.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. And when they get into marriage and they find out that the expectation is not met, then aggression begins to disappointment begins to set in.
That's true.
So we need have a right perception of things, have proper expectation. Don't over expect from your spouse, because everybody has got their weaknesses and their strengths.
Yes, yes.
So when you are going into a relationship, understand that this man, this woman, has his bad side and has his good side, and see things from that perspective so that you don't get highly disappointed. That's number one thing I will say. The second thing I will say is, in the relationship, we need to build boundaries. We are two different individuals in this relationship, and we have our right, we have our likes and our dislikes, and that needs to be communicated and respected. Because I'm married to you does not mean that you should overlook what things that are dear to me and just run over them. We need to have boundaries. We need to know this man doesn't like this kind of thing. This woman doesn't like and I respect that. And when we begin to, you know, have that boundaries in that. Our relationships, going to help us to prevent abuse. And the third thing I will say is lack of understanding our roles in marriage. For instance, a man that is maybe providing for his household, I mean, that's your job. Don't make it a big deal, and don't make it a song and singing to your wife or to your children that you know I'm the one for crying out loud. That is your role. So understand it is a privilege, embrace it, and don't make it something that you you smack on people's face and all that, and feel because you do that people should worship you.
Wow.
No. It's my role, and it's a privilege I'm doing it. So when people understand their roles in marriage, it's gonna prevent abuse.
Wow, what a wonderful contribution we've had today. Reverend Shade spoke about background, and you're speaking about wrong expectation and knowing your role. And I also think that you, to add to this, another thing that can also be a problem is taking each other for granted. You know, where a couple have been married, you know, the way the person was special to you before the marriage is now something that, you know, you kind of overlook, and you can't see the blessing anymore the way you saw it before. You know, a lot of times people get used to each other. I don't even know what happened. I mean, it's like maybe some people go for the physical look. So when they get the physical, the body of the person, they now get used to the person. But we want to say to people today, look for the blessing that is in your spouse. There is a character, there is a blessing in your spouse, which you can hardly find somewhere else. Value that, cherish that, you know, because some people always think that, you know, even if you leave, I can find someone else. You know, it's just about the physical. So we are not meant to take each other for granted. If we can value each other, alongside, you know, having a proper expectation, because that expectation too is a very powerful thing. Because when you overexpect, it becomes a problem.
Yeah.
You are not marrying a god. You know, one man said that if he wants to interpret what some women are looking for, they're looking for another god, you know, a supplier, you know, and then the men are looking for a kind of model, someone they use to show up, you know, to their friends and all that. Those are wrong expectations, and it causes problems. So I would like to take a short break quickly, and we'll be back to continue this. We have so much to share with you, and we believe that this is the right time for you to connect and understand these things before it manifests. Because I said before, I believe that, you know, when people don't know the right characters to manifest, they can ignorantly be a victim or a perpetrator of abuse. Yes, because sometimes you're fighting for yourself, but you don't know how to fight. So please, listeners and viewers, stay connected today. For those on Facebook, we will keep discussing these things. Thank you.
Making a bold statement yet blending into the surrounding suburbs of Melville, 27 Boxes is a realization of edgy design and practical implementation. A radical departure from the shopping malls of our generation, yet not a return to the high streets of our youth. 27 Boxes showcases the best of a shopping center set in a garden, surrounded by the bohemian suburb that is Melville. 27 Boxes, shop. Play. Eat.
Have you ever thought about the power of social media? Social media has the power to make your business grow. Grow! Yeah. Why don't you let us manage your social media? Because our business is to see your business grow. Visit us at www.beastownmedia.co.za.
Harnessing the power of talk radio. Brandlive.co.za.
Definitely patience is, be that as it may.
Okay.
If two people come together, always focused on how can we stay in agreement, there will never be a need for abuse.
That's true.
In fact, there'll be no need for that relationship to break. There'll be no need for that relationship to go sour. It can only grow, mature, and blossom into a healthy relationship. And why do I say that? Marriage is a covenant between a man. It's supposed to be a covenant between a man and a woman. Especially when we're looking at the perspective of a godly marriage. So a perspective of a godly marriage says a man is supposed to actually show up having not known another man. And a woman is also supposed to show up having not known another woman. And then they couple together in intercourse and in intimacy. And all the communication, irrespective of the customs, the legal boundaries, whatever, the spiritual aspect of that covenant is them coming together with the woman's hymen being broken by the man, and there being a little bit of a shedding of blood, which makes it a covenant. Now, a covenant is a relationship between two parties that says, until death us part. So God's original plan for marriage is for you to live and cleave together until death do us part. Now, do we have God's perfect situation running around now? Not necessarily. But it doesn't change the fact that that was God's original
plan. Okay.
So now, everything tells us that God wants you together. Now, if you can focus on God's plan of togetherness, it overrides every obstacle that will come after.
That's true.
So what are we saying? the most important key for me is the key of agreement. So if you can establish unity in that marriage, you'll have time for patience. You'll be able to take care of confrontations without falling apart. You'll be able to agree to disagree. Communication will become smooth or smoother as you learn to work with one another. Because you are in agreement, you are seeking to satisfy one another sexually. So you don't superimpose your sexual desire over your partner. You're seeking to satisfy your partner sexually, and you're seeking how your partner will satisfy you sexually. The individual needs. You're looking for, how can we have agreement when you don't care about my needs? No, but once we have agreement as a focus, you will care about what I need. You wake up in the morning and say, lovey, my babes, what is it that you'd like for today? How would you, what would make you happy today? And the other person is also looking for what would make you happy today. Now, you don't need any rocket science to tell you that if that's the objective of this relationship, that relationship will only grow from strength to strength. You talked about self-control and anger. That is no longer needed as a major issue. Why? Because the need to please one another will take away the frustration of anger, because you won't be working on getting angry and repeatedly talking about I always tell you, you always, you are forever. That is no longer a focus in your marriage, because anger and lack of self-control is a fruit of someone who is seeking only theirs. And then finally, comparison of your spouse to one another. No. If you are seeking unity in this home, if you are seeking agreement in this home, there's no rocket scientist that needs to tell you that comparing me with this woman is not unity, because that woman is not in this marriage. I am in this marriage. Or comparing you with some other man who is not in this marriage is here. If my dream was to marry that man, then I should be married to that man. If your dream was to capture a woman like this, then you should have met that kind of woman and married that person instead of deceiving me into marriage and now wanting to convert me into this other woman that you know. Wow. So when we look at all that, I find out that the most important key for me is the key of agreement, the key of walking together in unity.
No, that's very interesting. Even the Bible talks about the cleaving. I say the cleaving part is where couples have a problem. Some have left their parents, but they cannot cleave. And for me, that's when I wrote my second book, Living as One. Living as One is the process of cleaving. You know, so when you are working together, when you're making things together, living as one, you're working out a cleaving. When people can cleave, they don't have much problem. When they can become one, they don't have much problem. So I'm happy for the scenario you have painted through, even though the first one of the virginity, we need to pray about that.
God makes all things to become to new.
Great. So and you talked about the woman not knowing another man and coming together. You know, you are saying, when we're in Christ, we are new creatures, so we are new. And so this cleaving, I really support that. It's very important. Togetherness and oneness can be very important. But practically, let me ask Pastor Salako something. Practically, you know, people get unhappy. Things happen. You know, the scenario you painted is a good one, you know. But we know that, you know, things don't go the way we plan. So sometimes people get angry. And when they get angry, they kind of forget some things. They forget the goodness in this person. They forget the blessing of this person. Because I see that anger helps us to focus on the negativity of the person more than the goodness of the person. There are 1,000 things a person have done good. But just because you're angry in a moment, you can't see those things again. So how do we handle anger to still build this kind of relationship Reverend Shade has described?
One thing that we all need to cultivate is building a memorial for every good thing your spouse does. You see, in the Bible, Anytime Abraham encountered God, he builds a memorial. He builds an altar. What I mean by a memorial is document things. We are fond of documenting wrong things. He did this.
And people even have diaries to write evil things.
Please
don't do that again, please.
Instead of doing that, just
write the good things.
Start writing good stuff about, oh, today she did this, today he did this, and wow, what a wonderful. So that in the moment, because we are living in imperfect world, things are not going to be perfect every day. So in one of those days, you can just open up the book and just read. It will help you to manage things. That's number one thing. That another thing I'll say is communicating your expectation also helps.
It helps, yes.
Because in relationship, you find out that a man just expects a woman to understand what he's going through. A woman just expects a man to understand without communicating. So we need to learn to communicate our expectation. Because if you don't like this thing, and you don't tell me you don't like it, how will I stop doing it? Because
doing
I don't know that you don't like it. I mean, it may be something that, you know, is just normal to me. But if you don't take time to communicate it and just assume that you know, we are always going to get ourselves in trouble, and abuse can start from there. So those two things, cultivating the habit of writing good things about our spouses, and you know, communicating our expectation, will go a long way.
Wow, interesting.
If I can follow up on that, actually, to just leave people with a very practical thing. When there's a breakup in a marriage relationship and we're counseling, one of the most effective things that we like to do is to take that couple back down the memory lane. So we give the individual couples, individuals, an assignment, and we say, here is a sheet of paper numbered 1 to 20. Today, at this session, spend the next 10 minutes and write the first 10 things that you liked about the spouse that made you think, this is the person I want to marry. And then, by the time they write number 3, initially when they come in, they make you think this person is straight from hell. By the time they've written number 3, number 4, number 5, in fact, initially they may say, I can't find any good thing. But by the time they get
start
to number
writing.
3, number 4, number 5, they suffer. By the time they get to 10, you ask that question, you say, based on these 10 things, are you really serious this guy needs to be divorced? Or this woman needs to be sent out of your home? If they say, we don't know, these things have changed, then we now ask and say, how is it that marriage to you has converted these 10 things that they no longer exist? Do you think you are responsible? Or do you think it's purely them? And all of a sudden, you will find out that a couple that was hell-bent on going to divorce has a change.
Can work things out. Wow, interesting. That's a very practical thing, because it takes two to tangle. I mean, it doesn't just come from one person. So our listeners and viewers, because of time, we will be wrapping up here. But the good news is that we can stop abuse. With the understanding we have, with oneness, we've talked about background, whatever background you have, please ask God to take it away. We can do a U-turn, whatever it is, whatever happened in your family before.
For a new
beginning. Yes, it can change. And when we have the right expectation, like Pastor Salako said, we can work things out. And with the right characters, you know, when we walk by the word, the word is something that can help us to build the right characters that can overcome this abuse. It is very possible.
1 Corinthians chapter 13 can be your guideline.
Yes.
In any marriage, you don't even need any other scripture. You just need to say every day concerning your marriage between 1 Corinthians chapter 13 verse 3 to 11 or 12, you read this as a creed between your the two of you, and you find out that
it can really
overcome every problem.
Thank you very much.
And also,
thank you.
Another practical thing that couples need to do together is to pray together.
Okay, very important. That's very important.
The person that you stay closest to is the person you spend time
praying
in
with.
Praying. So that is very important.
It is
that
very, very couple important.
Couple creates time to pray together because it brings
unity
and bonding.
Togetherness. Wow, thank you very much. And I really think, you know, to sum it all up, if couples can sit together and share their heart in honesty with one another in a very unique way, in a way the person can accept, communicating their expectations, their hearts together, things can work out. So it is very, very possible. As long as there is love, anything is possible. So
you accept one another and
so
accept
friends,
the differences between each other. Once you have that background of accepting, anything else
is possible.
It's possible.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Reverend, for coming through. Thank you, Pastor. We're hoping to have an event next year.
Yeah.
By God's grace, we're looking at maybe February 16th.
Yeah.
You know, we're looking at something we call Marriage Clinic. It's going to be great. So please, listeners and viewers, put it on your diary. I will talk more about it in subsequent events. It's going to be in Fendel. We'll communicate the venue and all that. This is just a follow-up on things on how to help couples build, you know, the right marriage and enjoy their marriage. Thank you very much for coming. I'm so glad this went well. And I want to thank you for listening and for viewing. Stay connected. Next week, Monday, we will have another exciting topic to discuss. Thank you very much. God bless you. Thank you for coming.
Thank
I appreciate you.
Thank you
very much.
Live from 27 Boxes in the heart of Melville, this is brandlive.co.za.